The challenges facing our teens today mean that more than ever, we need to be there to support them and encourage them. The Dr. STEM Show is here to provide discussions about topics that will help promote healthy relationships, self-image, and success for teens, parents, and the community. Our young people can achieve more in life than they ever dreamed possible. The Dr. STEM Show, hosted by Dr. STEM Malatini, will foster these discussions and encourage your participation.
My name is Rodney Flowers now. Sorry, I forgot my name. No, I'm just kidding. I just want to welcome all of you. This is going to be aired on the Dr. STEM Show, so I also want to welcome the audience that will be watching this as part of the Dr. STEM Show. As you know, we have been profiling Rodney Flowers in Boston. This is his second time coming, but first time coming on the Dr. STEM Show. So I'm very excited to have you in Boston, as I say.
Thank you.
Too bad it's not long enough, but it's been a good
ride.
Great time. Yeah, it's been a great ride. A lot of people might not have watched the show that we did yesterday, so what I want to do is briefly tell your story as you introduce yourself to the audience that we have today.
Sure. My name is Rodney Flowers. My background begins in North Carolina as a young man, raised by my grandmother, and I moved to Lumberton, North Carolina to live with my mother when she got married, and as a young guy, I fell in love with the game of football, and that's what I wanted to do with myself. That was my dream, was to make it to the NFL, so I dedicated myself to that dream. Raised in a very Christian faith background in terms of religion, and had a strong belief in God that, you know, I could be successful and accomplish anything that I wanted. Mm-hmm. So I dedicated myself to football, and I got very good at it, honestly. I had good grades in school. I wasn't a bad kid. I avoided, you know, trouble with the law and things like that, all because, you know, I wanted to really, really excel in football. That's what I seen for myself. And during my second year playing organized football, I was in high school. I was in the 10th grade. I was 15 years old. And during my first game, I was starting tailback and cornerback for the Lumberton Pirates in North Carolina. And during the start of the third quarter, I was on the right side of the field playing special teams for the kickoff team. And I was running down the right side of the field, and I hadn't made a tackle or scored that game, and it was kind of unlike myself because I was typically all over the field and making plays. So I wanted to make a play because I felt like, you know, during this time of the game, I gotta do something. And so my intent was to hit the guy that was returning the ball as hard as I could to make a fumble so we can get the ball back. And so I ran down the field as fast as I could, and I made a tackle. And it was a great tackle, but I went down, and it felt like all of the energy in my body had literally just jumped out at that time. And I tried to get up, and I couldn't get up. And my mind hadn't caught up with the fact that my body was injured, so I could feel the motion of getting up in my mind, but my body wasn't responding. And I kept going through this motion over and over again. And I couldn't get up. And one of my friends that came over, he was actually my best friend at that time. He was like, good hit, man, get up, good hit, let's go. But I couldn't move. I couldn't get up. And he had reached down to grab me, and then the coaches realized something terrible was wrong, and they stopped him. And they came out, and they started asking me, hey, what's wrong? Get up, let's go. But I couldn't move. I couldn't get up. And so by then, my mother had made her way out to the field, and I was crying. I knew that I was in very bad shape and that my life was going to change. I knew I had suffered some type of spinal injury. And so they rushed me to the hospital to speed things up a little bit, and they had to take these large, like, you know, oversized bush clippers, okay, to cut my gear off my body because they didn't want to move me and want to keep me stable. And they began to, you know, do all of these tests on my body to determine the severity of the accident. And one of those tests involved, you know, the pinprick test, or the Asia test, the Asia exam. And what it involved was, you know, touching me with a light touch and asking me if I could feel it in different areas of my body. And then they would touch me with a pen, something sharp. And I couldn't feel any of it. And so they were making the assessment that something, you know, was really, really bad going on. And they started cutting the bottom of my feet. And they were cutting my feet to the point that my feet were bleeding. And my dad was in the room and he was asking me, hey, can you feel that? And I told him, no, I can't feel anything. And so I'm strapped down, I'm just looking straight up at the ceiling. I couldn't lift my head up to see what was going on. And I didn't even realize they were cutting my feet. That's just how much sensation I had lost. And so they, you know, loaded me into a helicopter because it was a trauma type of accident and that regional hospital couldn't handle that. So I was flown to Duke University Medical Center and they ran some more tests, and within 72 hours they diagnosed me as a quadriplegic and I would be paralyzed for the rest of my life. And so that, you know, created a domino effect of events and changes in my life. Obviously football was out the door, and you know, my life was turned upside down as well as my family's. And so I had to determine how I was going to continue on with life. You know, life had seemed to throw me a curveball, and I felt mad at the world and God and everyone else. I was very resentful of able-bodied people because I was now, you know, severely disabled, and I had to depend on someone for every single thing. I lost control of all bodily functions, and you know, it was a very sad moment, a very dark moment for me. The lowest I have ever been, and one of the most challenging things that I've ever had to face, even till today. And so I had to make a decision. Because I spent a year mad at the world about my condition. I would go and ask the doctors if there was something they could do for me, and there wasn't. There was no cure for spinal cord injuries. There was nothing they can do to fix it, and to this day there still isn't. There's some procedures out there now that can help if you get them, you know, soon enough, right after the accident. But still, there's no guarantees with those things. I think they're using some type of ice procedures now where they're freezing the spinal cord and things like that. But still, there's no, you know, permanent fix for this, okay? So I had to determine within myself if I wanted my life to be successful, if I wanted my life to be productive. Some things had to change within me because I couldn't get answers from anywhere else, my family, the doctors. And so I got fed up with the way things were and not experiencing the results that I wanted. And I realized that if things had to change, I had to change them. And it started with my attitude. The first thing that I changed was the way I viewed my accident. I think a lot of times when we are in challenging situations that we feel we can't overcome, we feel defeated. We feel that life has given us a raw deal and everything is bad, and we look at all the negative sides. And I can understand that because that's where I was. But today, the message that I give to people is to look at the positive side of every situation, no matter how bad there is, because there is a positive. There is a positive side. But you have to look for it. So, and we're going to talk about that. So that's just kind of the background. That's the foundation of my story, and how I started writing books, the success that I've experienced to this day. It all stemmed from a decision, which we're going to get into a little bit more. But that's the foundation of my story right there.
And as we are doing the discussions, I encourage the audience to just think through some questions that you might want to ask, because I'm going to give some time to the audience to ask some questions. And then for those people that are watching, after we record this, where can they get in touch with you to send their questions?
Can we continue on with even though? Okay. So you can reach me at www.rodneyflowers.com. I'm also very active on social media at www.facebook.com, Rodney Flowers Fans. I'm on Twitter at Rodney Flowers 22.
Okay. So now you've told us the story of where you are and you make a decision.
Sure.
Because I think for a lot of people, they want to know, how do I get
sure.
out of my situation, and how did you get to that point where you decided that you were going to get out of it?
Well, you know, honestly, I wanted to walk again, and I never gave up on that. Okay, that was my goal, and there was really no possible way that the doctor seen that I was going to be able to walk again. It just wasn't there. But I never gave up on that hope. I never gave up on that dream. But in addition to that, it wasn't just the desire to walk again. It was the desire to live. I had lost everything. I was 15 years old. You know, I hadn't went on my first date. You know, I hadn't, you know, graduated from high school. You know, I wanted to get a job. You know, those were all goals and dreams that I had as well. And I knew football would cover that. If I made it to football, then I'd always have all of that and plus more.
Yeah.
But, you know, those smaller goals became a lot more important after the accident, mm-hmm. because that too was, you know, at a loss. You know, I was threatened not to be able to accomplish those things. I mean, they didn't even think that I would finish high school. And so, you know, I looked at myself, I looked at my life, and I seen the fact that, wow, you know, the way it looks, I'm not going to be able to accomplish anything. And that really took a blow to my self-worth. And I just couldn't accept it. You know, the drive in me, you know, I was a very competitive individual by nature. I just couldn't accept that. And so in that decision, I came to the point where I said, you know what? I'm not going to let this defeat me. And I contemplated suicide, you know, sitting in my wheelchair. And it was the competitive nature in me, I think, you know, that kept me from killing myself. Because I remember so vividly sitting at a crossroad in my electric wheelchair, just waiting for an 18-wheeler to come streaming by and just roll myself out there in front of it to get rid of it all, because it was just that painful. Mentally and emotionally. But something within me was telling me that, well, if you do that, you definitely won't accomplish what it is that you want to accomplish, and you lose big time. This wins, because now it defeated you completely. It took your life.
Took you to your knees.
And so I said, that I can't go out like that. I can't go out like that. So, you know, I refer back to, you know, when I talk about thinking about the positive side of that. Because, you know, at that moment I said, well, how can I win? How can I defeat this? How can I make my life productive? And so I started looking for opportunities. And one of the opportunities that came to mind is the fact that I hadn't seen anyone do this before. I hadn't seen anyone, you know, suffer an injury at this age and recover. Not just walk again, but just have a success story. And so I wanted that to be me. And I knew if I did that, I could help so many people. And then I knew, when I think about being paralyzed, people would look at me and they could physically see my disability. But there's people walking around with disabilities and they're completely able-bodied. But when they get in that physical challenge or any type of life challenge, they break down. They can't overcome it. It consumes them. And so I wanted my life to symbolize success. I wanted my life to symbolize that thing that we call faith and being able to overcome, being able to accomplish our dreams, regardless of what gets in the way, because really that's what we're talking about. We're talking about being successful. And being successful is, you know, there's a thing that I like to say, that success goes to the person who's consistent in overcoming the demands of life. And that's what we're talking about, because life gives you so many demands. And it's those who are able to overcome those demands that reach the goal. You're going to have a lot of obstacles, a lot of mountains to climb, a lot of hills to get over. and we get tired, we get frustrated, and we don't want to do it, and it seems insurmountable. Oh, this is too big, or I don't have the strength to do it, or I just don't want to do it, right? But it's those who are consistent in overcoming those things that really make, you know, the difference in life, because those are the ones who are winning. Those are the ones who win. I thank God for the support group that I had, my mom and my family, because they really instilled in me some very, very profound principles that I still live by today. I mean, this was some very, very strong stuff that has helped me. Because I remember so vividly, my mom and dad, they had to do a lot for me, had to help me get dressed, take a bath, and do all these things, these personal things. And I would share with them some things about how I was feeling. And I remember talking to my mother about, you know, getting married and having kids and getting my own job and things like that. And I said, Mom, you know, how am I going to do this? And, you know, I have to deal with this stuff. I don't want to deal with it. No one else is going to want to deal with that. Or, you know, how can I be a man and sustain a household, be a father and things like that? And she told me something that sticks with me today. She said, there may be something wrong with your body. And there is. We can't get over that. But your mind, there's nothing wrong with your mind. Mm.
Yeah.
And so that changed everything for me. She said, you know, there's nothing wrong with your mind. So I was on paper, according to the doctors, paralyzed. But I wasn't paralyzed. Because my mind was still working. And I started to understand who I am. I am a spiritual being created by God with an intellect. I have an intellect. My body is just where I live. But it's not who I am. It's just where I live. It's just the manifestation of the physical manifestation of my personality. It's what you get to see.
You ever thought about being a pastor? Because you're just like ministering. I feel like saying amen.
That's what I'm sitting here saying in my head. Amen.
I just feel like saying amen.
And so with that understanding, I realized I can do anything that I want to do. Once I put my mind to it. So the mind is key. The mind is key to accomplishing anything, being anything that you want to accomplish. And there are some other things that I learned that I'll share with you. One thing that if you really want to know the fundamental thing that sticks with me, and I learned this later in life, is my purpose. If you want to talk about purpose, a lot of people go through life, they don't know what their purpose is. And this is my philosophy of purpose. You know, through my study, I've learned that, you know, everything here, the trees, the distance from the earth, the distance from the sun and the moon, the way that we orbit, the trees, the grass, everything here is created for us. You call it the universe, call it God, whatever you want to call that source of energy that created us. It was for life. And if you look at the things here on earth, if you look at the trees, you look at the birds, you look at all the things in nature, all of those things, they're here for us. They create beauty. They're nice for us to look at. And it reproduces itself. Life sustains itself. You know, when something is planted and it brings forth itself, it leaves a seed so that life can continue on. We do the same thing, and now we have seed in terms of being able to reproduce and make more people, make babies. But I challenge you to take a deeper look, because all that you gain here in your success, all the money that you have, the cars, the fame, you can't take that with you. It serves its purpose because you can enjoy it while you're here, but you can't take it with you. But what does that mean when you're gone? If you have all this money, what value does that bring? It's very little. Even though it brings a lot of enjoyment when you're here, you can use it. But when you're gone, it's not like you had a lot of money, so what? But what people remember is the difference that you made in their lives, the character, you know, actually the life that you were able to instill into someone else. And so that understanding led me to a higher awareness of what I'm supposed to do, my purpose here. And I challenge you to believe that your purpose is to increase life. Mm-hmm. Well, how do you increase life? Well, you increase life by becoming the best you that you can be. Mm-hmm. There's a famous quote by Wallace D. Wallace that says, the best thing that you can do for this world, for yourself in this world, is to make the most of yourself. Because in your doing that, you increase your life and the lives of others. And so that was very important to me. And so I knew that because I was still alive, that I didn't die, that I still had a purpose. And that purpose was to help as many people, to bring as much life to people, to myself and to the people around me as I can, because that's what people are going to remember about Rodney. That's what people are going to remember about you, the difference that you were able to make in their lives. Now, we all have gifts, but it's what you do with those gifts that makes the difference. Now, you can take that gift and you can sit on it. You can say, I can't be whatever I want to be. But those desires and dreams that you have within you are there, not just for you. They're there for you and for those around you, because if you think about it, if I had not pushed the way I've pushed, accomplished what I've accomplished, I couldn't sit here and talk to you and give you what I'm giving you. But you have the same thing in you. It may not be sitting here and delivering the message that I'm delivering, but there's something about you that somebody needs to see. And it could be playing basketball. It could be being an author. It could be being a pastor, a teacher. It could be whatever it is that your desire that really drives you, pumps you up, and makes you want to get out of bed every day and go for it. I say do it, because you don't know who else it's going to affect. And then look at it this way. If you don't do it, you don't know who that is affecting. You don't know who you're not helping. You don't know who you're not bringing life to. It works in both ways. So I encourage you to fulfill your dreams. Write your book. Whatever it is that you want to do, give it everything that you got, because it's your purpose.
And let me just add on to that, because then a lot of people always wonder, you know, how do I find my purpose? How do I find my passion? And writing is really, really good, you know, for you to get to write every day what you're doing on a daily basis, what you think you like or what you like. And in that, some people, you know, think I'm writing a book, and yet what you're writing is actually formulating your own life and what it is that you like. So I'm glad that you mentioned that purpose. I'll tell you another thing about Rodney. The way that we met, you know, people undermine social media today. But, you know, I mean, the way that we met, I mean, of course, we're part of network, you know, the life.
How are your life?
How are your life network, where you saw my picture. But then inboxed me in Facebook, and we started chatting in Facebook. And it's amazing that this is our first time meeting, but when you are on a mission and you start, you know, dreaming, you know, about something and wanting to do something, that the connections that you make, you know, I mean, will just get you in that path of where it is that you want to go. So as I said, as we started, you know, I'm so excited to see all of you here, and I know somewhere, somehow, our paths have crossed, and it is for a reason. So if anything, just watching you the last 2 days, 3 days that we've been together doing work in Boston, I can't tell you how many times I've cried after dropping home, you know, and getting my car, and I start crying to say, what is it that stops me if I wanted to even dream bigger than where I am today? What is it that stops me if I wanted to do more than what I wanted to do today, because of that message that he said, you know what, if you can get up and you can think and you can talk and walk. Mm-hmm. You can do anything that you want to do mm-hmm. and become anybody that you want to become.
Yes.
I see him trying to get up, you know, with assistance. The first day, I wanted to help a lot. And I'm holding this and I'm holding that. He's like, oh, okay, okay. You know, I'm okay.
This.
And I'm thinking, well, but then I'm seeing him shake. And he's like, listen, I would get up. And what man could I be if I can't get up and try to do as much as I can to get up on my own?
That's right.
And to me, just him doing things like that, and I'm thinking he really is leaving the book that he wrote.
Mm-hmm.
He still has struggles that he's struggling with and still on a day-to-day basis without even, and I was telling him yesterday, to say without you even saying a word, just to watch him and to read his book. Books, actually there are two of them, but to see him on a day-to-day basis, even now when he's signing books and everything, and to see how he's so determined to write your name in the book and actually write a message in the book and then hear his story. I mean, I'm sure not only, you know, the group that's in here is inspired by your story, but the whole world is going to be inspired by your story.
Right.
So tell us about Get Up.
Before you do that,
yeah.
Dr. Stem, I just want to touch on one issue that came up yesterday when you mentioned handicap. All right, and I got you on that one. And I'd like maybe Rodney just to explain that for our audience so that they know the difference between being handicapped and being challenged. Because my argument yesterday was that we all have challenges. They may not be physical, they could be mental, they could be, you know, all sorts of challenges.
Mm-hmm. Sure, I mean, we're all physically challenged, we're all mentally challenged,
mm-hmm.
we're all intellectually challenged.
Mm-hmm.
And we're operating on different levels, we all are. However, society, all right, has labeled people that they visualize with some type of physical challenge as abnormal,
mm-hmm.
handicapped,
disabled.
Can't do. Okay. And being a person that has received that label, I don't receive it, but has been labeled that, you know, and having a higher understanding, you know, I'm not handicapped, I'm not disabled. There's a lot that I'm able to do. I mean, I may need help, but when you really think about it, it's a very ignorant type of
stereotype.
Label to put on people. I mean, you know, we all need help in a certain degree. I mean, you can't get into your house, you couldn't, if you didn't have the steps, not without, you know, getting some help to get up to the door, you know, but steps are like a reasonable accommodation. But because it's so normal, you know, and some of the help that I need may be considered abnormal, right, I have that disability, but it's all the same thing, okay? We all have different, I can't go out here and drop 41 points in a game like this brother may be able to do. Right, but you don't label the rest of the world disabled because they can't go and drop 41 points in a game, right?
Right.
So it's just ignorance in my mind. But you know, at the same other side of the token, you can take people who break down in a physical challenge, who you know are weak when it comes to approaching their goals or dealing with adversity, or they don't know how to deal with people. You know, they always want to fight. That could be considered a disability.
Mm-hmm.
Someone who can't learn simple things like, you know, how to shake someone's hand and look them in the eye, how to have confidence, you know. So we all have physical limitations, okay? But I think there's strength in that, okay? And that's why it goes back to what I was talking about before. Because I may be weak in one area and you are strong, that makes the need for you to do what you do and I do what I do more important so that we can help each other, all right? But what we do is we look at a person's physical limitation, and if it's not up to par with what we think or what society thinks, oh, we want to cast them out. Wrong thinking. Wrong thinking. Wrong thinking. There's something about that individual that's good by law. For every up, there's a down. For every left, there's a right. It's called the law of polarity. Okay, just like in every situation, there's something positive. You got to look at it. In every person, regardless of how bad they look, there's something good about that person.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to go look for it. You got to have that type of eye. But if you're negative yourself and you're not looking for that, you're missing it.
All you're going to see is negative.
So that's what I think about that, you know. And so It's a challenge because society, you know, society has to change. Society has to raise their consciousness. They have to raise their awareness to that idea in order for it to be more accepted. But just be careful labeling people handicapped or disabled, you know, because I think just, you know, being around other people, there's some amazing people. Some of the most amazing people that I've met have been people that are physically challenged. You know, I went to college and this guy named Bert, he lives in Virginia, a very successful individual. He has CP, cerebral palsy. One of the nicest, most genuine guys that I ever met. Just a down-to-earth good guy. Has CP. You know, but so what? There's something about you that's physically limited. There's something about all of us that's physically limited. When I was 15, I could run a 4.5 40. I could bench 215 pounds at that time. I could go to my neighbor and the guy that was living there, he couldn't do that. He couldn't run that fast. But, you know, he was not less of a man than I was or anyone else because of that. So it's a facade to think that someone, just because they have a physical limitation, that they're less.
So what I'm going to do is, because I want to give people a chance to ask you questions.
Sure.
Before we go outside, because we're going to be doing the book signing outside as well. So real briefly, tell us a little bit about Get Up, the book, the title, and how that came to be.
Yeah, so Get Up, it's I'm screaming to the world to get up, the way that the audience and my mother and the trainers were yelling at me on the field to get up. And I couldn't get up, at least I thought at that time I couldn't, but I physically couldn't get up. And it takes you through me, because I'm up now. I'm completely up. And it was a process for me to get up. And just like if you're laying on the floor, you just don't jump to your feet, you know. Mm-hmm. There's a process that you go through to get up. And at first, mentally, I felt like I couldn't. That's why I say I can't, I will, I did, and I'm telling you how. I can't because I felt at one time that I could not do it. I couldn't get up. And then I made a decision. I said that I will. And once I made that decision, you know, I reached the manifestation, and I did. And the book shows you how. There's principles in this book that allowed me to make that change. One of them is, you know, don't just do it for you. Do it for those that need to see you do it. That was motivation for me. An inspiration to, you know, I had to do this because of the mark that I wanted to leave on the world. I demanded more from myself than anyone else, from any doctor, from any therapist, from any parent, from any teacher. You know, that's just what I wanted. And there's a chapter in there that talks about that. Be willing to do whatever it takes, which is another chapter. So I'll walk you through how to deal with the demands of life. Basically, that's what it is. And there's principles that are going to help you in just about any situation you may find yourself. You know, you may find yourself, you know, dealing with temporary failure. And that's what failure is. It's temporary. It's a learning experience. It's not that it won't work. It's that maybe it won't work that way. And maybe you need to try a different way or a different route. Or maybe there's something that we need to learn. Maybe there's something that we don't know. But whatever idea that you have in your mind, it can work if you continue to work it and you don't give up. And if you look at the forefathers of the world here, you look at some of the luxuries that we enjoy now, that is evidence that anything that you put to your mind, it can happen. The automobile, the airplane, the light bulb, you know, the buildings, it just about everything is evidence that it will work. And if you really want to look at it, everything that you see in here and out there in the world, no matter how big it is, it was nothing more than an idea in someone's mind at one time. And that is a powerful statement. Because if you can understand that, then you can understand that we can do anything. I mean, you're talking about a spaceship was an idea in someone's mind. Mm-hmm. And they stuck with it. Now, it took a lot that went into that. And some of it took years, but so what? Whatever your goal is, if it means enough to you, you will put forth the effort and the time to make that thing come true. And that's what our goals and our dreams, they begin as little seeds, little ideas that have to go through the incubation period in order to reach the full manifestation. And that involves, you know, a little discomfort. When you're changing and you're growing, you know, sometimes it's a little uncomfortable. But we have to continue to go through that process in order to get where we're trying to go. It's simple fundamental principles. I mean, success is a simple thing. It is very, very, very simple, but it's difficult for a lot of people to follow. But it's very simple. It's just like riding a bike. You never knew how to ride a bike. You get on it, you fall off. What do? You get back on it. Some of us need little training wheels. Some of us have to ride the bike, you know, with training wheels a little bit longer. Sometimes you're gonna get little bumps and bruises along the way. But in the end, if we focus on the end, we ride the bike. That's the ultimate goal. We get up.
Okay. So what I like about this book is, you might wonder why we have the two books in here today, with the one that I wrote in 2009. I wrote Beyond the Tears, and this one came up when?
That one came out this year, March of this year.
This one came out this year. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing because then, you know, I talk about that Beyond the Tears, which I'm sure you shed
many tears,
that there's always, always hope and encouragement. So it's interesting how the chapters that you write here, even as I think back when I wrote my book, and as I continue on this journey, we are both motivational speakers, and right now we are both on a journey to empower, motivate, and inspire people. So we are going to be going out speaking together as well for his company, and then he's also going to be speaking for my company. So what I like about his titles, they are titles that when you think about achieving success or just getting to the next goal, they are titles that you open up and you say, man, I'm tired. I don't know if I want to get up. And Rodney says, you know what, tired? Do it anyway. And then I opened up the book. I was like, oh man, I'm tired today. So I opened up the book today and I saw, tired, do it anyway. I'm like, oh boy, here we go. And then, you know, it says, always push yourself to levels above the social average. So no matter how much you think you've accomplished, when you look at yourself and you challenge, 2016 is coming up, and you think, oh man, I did it, 2016 is coming up, you know, you got to push yourself beyond whatever it is that you have done. But what he says and what I say is, you've got to believe in yourself and know that it's in you. If it's going to happen, then it's got to be you. Whatever needs to happen, it has to be you. It's not going to be mom, dad, situation, social environment, money, or no money. You can do it. Why? Here's another chapter. Because you can. If you have a dream that is so big that the world needs to know, situations are going to happen in your life that you look back and you just go, what just happened? It's because you've got to move, and you have to be moved to bigger and better. When it happens at that moment, it's almost like, man, I can imagine when he was in that wheelchair, and he's in an electric wheelchair. Many people are still in those wheelchairs. Right. Whether it's an actual wheelchair, or it's a wheelchair that is mentally for us, for able-bodied, mm-hmm. that you're sitting there and you're still operating in that wheelchair, mm-hmm. and you don't have the determination to get out of that wheelchair. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, if you're lucky, the winds will blow you out, and situations will blow you out so that you can move out of that wheelchair, that mind frame, that certain place that you're in, whether it's a job, whether, you know, I mean, it's you need to go to school, you need to write a book. The winds will just blow you there, and you go, what happened? And then when you look back, you see exactly that. You know what? I finally came up with that book that I've been wanting to write, and I didn't realize that by me losing my job, by me getting a divorce, by me having this, this is what pushed me to that place where I have, you know, to be. So, you know, I mean, not only are you inspiring with your story, I continue to tell people, there's a YouTube clip, it's like 7 minutes of his story. If you watch that, even if it's, you know, daily or once, it will just drive you even more to see his story, because then you see him in the bed when he got hurt, and you see his parents talking about how it was for them seeing him there and knowing that he can't get up. Because remember now, he's the NFL player that's about to just change everybody's life. The whole family's life is going to change because he's getting picked. And all of a sudden, it's gone right in front of your eyes. So you get to see their pain when they talk about it as well. So I'm going to get another question. Ms. Butler wanted to ask a question too.
Yes. I wanted to ask you that because I actually deal with challenges, mentally, physically, challenges of clients that I serve. Now, how do I get them to understand? I had told my story to them, and now I want them to utilize my story and realize that I learned something from my trials, my tribulations, my situations, and I chose not to stay on my knees. I chose to be a conqueror and to get up when I fall, because everybody makes mistakes. But what would you give me to take back to the clients that I serve who feel as though they can't get up?
Well, you can't change anyone. You can't change their attitude. They have to do that themselves. The only thing you can do is live the best life that you can live and be an example. You can't force nothing on people, but people should be able to see you,
right,
and see your life, see the things that you're accomplishing, the results that you're getting, and then want to partake in the principles that you are implementing into your life. So if you want to take back something, and if you're getting up and you're conquering, people should be able to see that. You shouldn't have to tell them that.
Right.
They can see that, and as a result of that, you inspire them.
I want to start by saying thank you, Mr. Flowers, for your presence. It's a blessing. I'm very grateful for all the inspiration that you actually gave me in the last, half hour.
Yeah, right?
I'm very, very lucky to be here to hear you speak, and it's very inspiring. You spoke about challenges. I challenge myself every day. I'm talking 24 hours a day. I make sure I continuously challenge myself, and I set the bar very high.
Sure.
You're a challenge.
Oh,
to all of us.
I continuously, my outlook is a life without a challenge is a life without growth.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And what I can give back as my own story of being a voice. I was at a speaker series, and one of my favorite speakers was speaking. It was Les Brown.
Yes.
He's a motivational speaker. And I got to have lunch with him, and I got to talk to him personal, and I know it was with his son. And a lot of his story, his personal background was so inspiring. And he really made the seed that we talked about, how you just got to just continuously evolve and adapt. And literally, I got his book, and I said, I want to write a book. I want to write books, and I have a voice that I want millions of people to hear. I have a story that can help so many people change their lives, and I have that hunger,
yeah,
and I'm here today to say thank you. And my question is there are so many challenges when you want to write a book, and so many different, and before I get into that, you went through Facebook and social media.
Sure.
In today's era, we need to virtualize. It's a new era of marketing. It's a new era of game planning and strategically preparing yourself to really logistically go out and implement, you know, your voice in your book. And I think it's very crucial to understand that you have to be hungry. And your hunger, everyone can taste your hunger. I think being enthusiastic for life is important. Having passion, it's contagious. And I can feel it in the room today. And there's a lot of people in this room today that I can feel it. And I want to know, what were some of the challenges you faced when you first made that move, when you planted that seed, like, hey, I'm going to write a book about my story. And what were some of the obstacles, and how did you persevere through that?
Well, when I made that decision, I was blessed to have a mentor. Okay, I had thought about writing a book, you know, long before I actually did it, because I knew the story was inspiring. I was making slow progress when people were seeing that, you know, like, wow, this is inspiring. Look at this guy; he's recovering beyond what anyone expected. You should write a book. But I quite wasn't where I wanted to be. I wanted to be completely out of the wheelchair. So it wasn't until I got out the wheelchair that I said, now it's time to write the book. And I went to a seminar, and it was a self-development seminar, and I met a young lady there. And so I had this idea in the back of my mind, didn't know how to really bring it forward. And so when I met this young lady, she was a New York Times bestseller. She had wrote 6 books, all of them bestsellers. And she had a program. Her name was Peggy McCall. She wrote the foreword for my second book. And I took a course, and that helped me bypass a lot of the pitfalls that you find with authors who don't know some of the things that she teaches. And so, honestly, I didn't face a lot of challenges. I was blessed because she taught me a lot. And so that's why when I wrote my book within, before I even launched my book was a bestseller. My launch date was a Tuesday, the Sunday before, my book was a bestseller. I don't know how that happened because I didn't tell anybody that I was putting it on Amazon. I told everybody it was coming out Tuesday, but it was a bestseller the Sunday before. So that was just a blessing. So, but I would say what you need to do so you don't face a whole lot of challenges is find yourself a good mentor, someone who's been in the game and it's been very successful, and let them teach you and coach you on how to do it. Writing a book is a process. I've broken it down to make it very simple for me, just from the people that I've dealt with. And what I do is I outline the topics that I want the book to demonstrate, okay? Mm-hmm. And once I have all those topics, I go to each topic and I say, what do I want my audience to get out of this topic? And I can develop questions for that. I answer the questions in as much detail as possible. And then I take the answers and put them in a chapter format. It's kind of like writing a paper for each chapter, okay? Or essay for each chapter, however big you want it. And then that's how I do each chapter until it's done. And then I get my buddies and my friends to read it, and I give it to the editor. And then you go through the wickets of, you know, book layout. But I'll tell you, that's not the hard part. Writing a book is very easy once you get that concept down and you're comfortable with writing. Marketing is where 95% of the work is, okay? If you are going to write a book, what I recommend is you go ahead and establish yourself in the market right now as an authority. What I mean by that, start creating your brand of who you are. Start putting out content that's going to be similar to what is going to be in the book. Okay? So if you're going to be motivational, start putting out motivational quotes. Start letting people see you and what you're trying to give. Whatever you're offering, start offering it now. The book is just going to be a byproduct of you. You have the information. The book is just one of the products that you put out. But you are your brand. You are your product. Okay? The book is just part of that. So start serving people with your product, with your service.
I can guarantee you that by this time next year, when we go around again, that young man's book will be out and a bestseller, because he already has the story, as you're saying. It's just putting it down. And now that he's going for his PhD, I'm talking about Brian Castellanos. Now that he's going to his PhD, the story, the way that he tells it already, he's a motivational speaker, he's an inspirational speaker, renowned. He's been speaking for a long time. So I know that already the book is outlined and written. One of the things that Rodney is doing as well, he's also a coach. So for those of you that are watching, those of you that are here, you can also retain him as a coach. And even if you get the surface of how to write the book, he's got the connections that he can connect you with the other right people as well. So I just want to make sure that everybody knows and understand that. Yes. Anybody else with a question?
Just get back to Brian, and I would like to see it because I would like to personally endorse your book whenever it's done.
So just send it to me. Alright, you better start writing, bro.
Mr. Flowers, the chicken story. Don't look at me like that.
Tell us a chicken story. You do! Say it's a chicken story.
Wow. Good job, Swat.
I'm just a country boy from North Carolina. So we were having lunch yesterday, and Fungi wanted to know, my past is past. And, you know, how I was raised and you know, where I come from. And I was telling them that, you know, I come from the South, a very country town. It's where I live, a place called Rayford. You know, no one probably ever heard of it.
Now they do.
And it's deep into the country. You know, I was telling them I was country boy. So I went to next door to order lunch, and, you know, she was asking me what I want. I said, you have sweet tea? She was like, no. I said, you have a Dr. Pepper? She was like, I think so, but are you from the South? I was like, yeah, why? Because I ordered sweet tea, and this is Boston, I guess.
Right.
So you probably hear it in my accent. I'm a country boy, but I'm proud of it. And, you know, I was raised on a small farm, and, you know, early in the mornings, my grandmother would make me go out. We owned it, you know, a chicken coop, and, you know, I've eaten the unpasteurized eggs and chickens, and my grandmother would go out and grab a chicken, and she would bring its neck and let it go. And, you know, that would be our dinner for the night, you know. She cleaned it and did all those things. So that's my story. That's the chicken story. So, it wasn't just chickens. We had hogs and things like that. So had to take care of the animals, and, you know, we had a field where, you know, we picked peas and corn. We grew a lot of the food that we ate and things like that. But to say, you know, it's not where you are. It's where you want to go. You know, and if you come up with the idea, you know, because when I look back in my life, I look at where I come from. I'm like, wow, this is totally different now. And then I look at even where I want to go, it is a lot different than where I am right now.
Yeah.
But that's encouraging because, you know, we can paint a picture, we can paint an image in our minds. That's the beauty of our imagination. I thank God for that. That is a true gift of God, is your imagination, because you can imagine what you want your life to be like. You can dream dreams. Don't let anyone kill your dreams, because dreams are a very real thing. Some of the things that we enjoy today are the dreams of other people. Okay. When you paint that picture and that image in your mind and you hold it in your mind, it's something fascinating that happens. And I wanted to touch on this. You were talking about it earlier, how people, you know, the fact that we are here and the way that happened. You know, when you start pursuing a goal and you're very passionate about it, things seem to start happening. Okay? When you are pursuing things, when you are trying to increase life in yourself, in the life of others, and you're doing it by your thoughts and your imagination, when you're doing that, you're actually following the same laws that nature uses that actually allowed you, yourself, to be created, all the things in the universe to be created. I mean, I don't know if that resonates with you or not, but that's a very powerful thing. You know, we're all created from an idea. We're all created from nothing to something. That's how it works. All right? You can think of a thing, and then you can watch that thing manifest. Your dreams are the same way. Truly are. You can think a thing.
I have a comment. I wasn't supposed to be here today, but I think God brought me here to listen to all of this.
Sure.
I came to support for a few minutes, but what really got me to stay and cancel my appointment to move it later on was the fact that we were about to take a picture, and you were like, I gotta get up. Why am I writing about get up and I'm sitting down? And you know, it takes you a few minutes to get up, but you did it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
We have everything and the use of everything, and we don't get up. I mean, it took me 14 plus years working in corporate America to finally say, you know what, I'm going to own my own business. So you've really inspired me. I feel like you and Dr. Stamps both complement each other, because without the confidence and without putting fear aside, I don't think we'll be able to get up. So now that I have my confidence, I know what I'm capable of, I love fashion, I feel like your book is so powerful, I'm going to be able to get up. So awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I want to talk about, can I talk about a couple of things that she said? I want to talk about fear, which is a very paralyzing emotion. Mm-hmm. Okay. Fear, past experiences, is a very paralyzing emotion. You have to push through fear. Fear, let me educate you about fear. Fear is kind of like working out. I'm sure you can work resonate with this. When you work out, let's say there's a weight that you couldn't push, all right? Lifting weights, and it seems too heavy, all right? Or uncomfortable. You might can move it, but you can't do it the way you really want to. Not independently, because it might hurt yourself, right? You feel that way because you are unfamiliar with that weight. Mm-hmm. Okay? Public speaking. I used to be afraid to get up here and talk to people. I'll tell you.
You never know.
Really?
You would really
never know it.
Really, really was.
Powerful. All
right? But see, if you do it, and you push through that discomfort, you get comfortable with it. You know, you've been in the gym, right? You get comfortable with it
this morning.
So once you get comfortable with it, that weight doesn't intimidate you anymore.
That's right.
Okay? Even though it once did. So now you're on to the next one, right? A heavier weight, right? But you know you can conquer the heavier weight because
you did that.
And so that's what fear is all about. Now, there's some fears that are bigger than others because the risk may be a little bit bigger, right? And so you have to push through that thing. And you have to ask yourself, if I don't do this, what are the risks? So we only look at the fear of, let's say, public speaking, making a mistake or making a fool of yourself, blah, 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 right? But the other side of that coin is, if you don't do it, you don't reach your success, you don't grow, you don't do those things that you really want to do. So you have to break through that terror barrier. And see, a lot of times it's raising your awareness, you know, to the new thing. It's new territory, and so it seems unfamiliar, it seems foreign. And then the fear is telling you, oh, you can't do that, you're not good enough, you know. It's a bad idea. That's what we got to look at that as. That's a bad idea. We don't want to entertain that idea. We want to entertain ideas that are going to get us to where we are trying to go. And so it's an emotion, right? It's the paradigm. It's the other side of you that's trying to protect you, right? Because there's an inner thing in you that tries to protect you, right? But you got to push beyond that, because now you're that programming that's within you, that's been instilled in you all your life, you know, all those limiting, those belief systems and things like that that's inside of you, is telling you you can't do that. But you got to know consciously within yourself that you can, and you have to push through that thing. That's how I deal with fear. I was afraid when I first wrote the book. It's like, oh, I want you to say something. Like, oh my God, you know what I mean? But I can't sell the book, or I can't help the people that I want to help. You know, and then I'm screaming, get up, but you're afraid. You can't, you got to practice what you preach. You know, so, you know, that's how I had to get over fear. And, you know, even on my job, I'm very successful on my job. I'm in a leadership position. I had to lead people. I had to deal with, well, I have a physical disability, and no one is going to listen to me. And I have one of the most highly performing teams at work now.
All right.
You know, but it was pushing through the fear and saying, no, I can. We will. You know. I did it anyway. So that's how you deal with it.
All right. Anybody else? Joe, I want to hear from you. What do you think about all the stuff that's happening? Did you get something?
Yeah, I think when you were talking about purpose.
Sure.
Because when I was 8 years old, I got into an accident. You know. It was in the summer. I got ran over by a pickup truck, and I broke my leg. And I was in a wheelchair that whole summer, so I couldn't like do anything with my friends or But it's just like, I was just watching it, just like, damn, like, I don't want to be here. And I was like, I remember my mom telling me, like, I was very close to dying. And, like, in the hospital, I was just thinking, like, God gave me another chance. Like, there's a purpose. Like, I have a purpose to do something. It could be playing basketball, or it could be
absolutely
something else. Like, I know, I just know I have a purpose.
That's good.
So that's what I always think about. Like, I can't slack. I can't. Absolutely. I just have to keep on pushing.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yes. We've got two people who haven't really asked questions here.
You don't want to ask questions, Richard. You don't want to talk. Trust me.
I don't have questions. Maybe just a comment or two.
Sure.
I've been inspired a lot, and I think it is. I was talking to STEM like 2 days ago, contemplating between coming here and above and maybe working 15 hours a day for money. And I was talking to her, I need money so bad right now. I may come to this place and I get one word that can change my life.
Sure.
And I'll tell you that I've successfully accomplished my deal.
Wow.
Yeah.
This one is has been more than a year of hours of working.
Wow.
So I don't regret it. It has been, I think among these people, I come from the farthest place, I don't know. I came from Waltham to come here. And I had to cancel my day's program from like 8 to 11 p.m.
Mm.
So I was supposed to work all that long, and I canceled it to come here. But I think in me, I have a lot of things that I can do, and this has been inspiring to me. There is another guy I watched, is he called Eric or something? I come from Uganda in East Africa, and there is a guy they brought, I think he's a motivational speaker too. And for him, he didn't have limbs at all, no hands, no legs.
That's me.
It's a Nick.
Nick. So the guy talked to us, and he was, I think he wrote a book, and the book is like, what is your excuse? So, you've been talking and I'm thinking that I'm down here and I'm supposed to be way up there. And when we come here, some of us who came at old age immigrants, we get soaked into hours and thinking about short-term things, money today, and before realizing maybe your talent is gone, maybe time is wasted because you're looking short term. So if you get off time like this, it may build you, it may change you. I'll take your contacts and maybe you'll be one of my mentors in my
awesome
next thing.
Well,
thank you very
much.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
thank you. Awesome. Thank you.
I got another question.
Yes.
So many times there's guys that motivate me. Many times that I'm sure that people that watch this get inspired. But it's like, you watch the person, you listen to the person, you're inspired for that moment, but don't know how to harbor that. You know what I'm saying? Like you said, you for 18 years you was in the chair and you was thinking about it and you was focused on it. How can you, you know what I'm saying, give advice for someone to harbor what they feel right at this moment, right when they're talking to you, right when they're seeing you, how do they harbor that and move to the next level?
I would advise you to buy my book, Essential Assertions for Women. That's why that book was written, to be honest with you, to address that exact question. I recommend whatever it is that you're desiring. I'll tell you what I do, and this is real talk, okay? This is exactly what I do. I have a board, a window in my bathroom, and it has everything that I want on that window. And it has words like discipline, faith, sacrifice, commitment. It's on that window. And every day when I go in that bathroom, I look at that mirror, okay? And I look at the things that I want, all right? And so every day I'm re-inspired, okay, of what I want. I have a check in here. I showed it to Dr. Stan. I have a check in my pocket that I carry with me every single day. And I look at this check because I have to take it out of my pocket and put it into whatever I'm wearing for that day, okay? It's right in there. that's what keeps me going, because that is my goal. See, my goal is something that I work on every day, and I keep it in front of me every single day. So I would recommend, once you are clear about what it is that you want to do, you have that image, you write that image down. And you write it in a tense that you already have it. Not, I'm happy because I'm going to get. I'm happy and grateful now that I have, or I am. Whatever it is that you want. And you put it somewhere where you can see it every single day.
That's funny you say that, because I got a banner at my house, in my hallway. What is that?
The world is yours. Go get it.
Yeah. So I made that. It's the same thing. I just like people to understand that it's not just one time hearing someone. You have to actually repeat.
That's right.
And actually get these, be able to bring these feelings up that you feel when you listen to someone who's inspiring.
And see, you just said the key word is the feeling. I wasn't going to go into this, but I am now because you said that. Do I need to stop?
No, I'm like, real brief.
Okay, real quick. Okay, so the way your mind works, okay? I don't know if you ever heard of this thing called a stick person, but the way your mind works, you have a conscious and a subconscious mind. In your conscious mind, that's the part of you that's able to accept or reject ideas, okay? And so when something is good or something that you want enters into your conscious mind, you allow it. Let's say, I want a Bentley, okay, just as an example. You're like, yeah, I want that. But if it doesn't resonate with you, you don't get emotional enough about it, you're not going to work towards it every day. When it gets deep into your subconscious mind, you start to develop the faith. You get emotional about that, and then it puts your body in motion, and then you reap the results of those behaviors, and you get the Bentley. Okay, that's what we're talking about here. And so it's being emotionally attached to the things, the desires, the dreams that you want out of life, because then it affects your daily behavior.
So quick, this would be quick.
Yeah.
I went yesterday, as soon as I was on Facebook, I clicked go.
Oh, yeah.
I followed the rest of it.
Yeah.
And I looked at someone what he had on his page.
Sure.
It said, how to be successful. On RodneyFiles.com, there's goals, study, improve your social skills, manage your time, protect your health, and dream.
Yeah.
And I screenshotted it. I made sure to screenshot that book, because I'm on the fly, I'm busy, but I'm always virtualized. I'm always, you know, seeing. You got to practice good habits. A habit of mine is researching success, researching, studying people's stories, managing. It's resource management. And I feel so inspired by your words today, and you gotta have a vision board.
Absolutely.
Every day I look at my vision, I remind myself. And the best part about the vision board, you can dream up a good dream. That last piece when you said dream, you can modify it whatever way you want it.
It's your dream.
Yeah.
It's your dream. But thank you.
Okay, just one comment. We've got a very young gentleman here. He's being mentored by Andre. Our advice to you is stay with Andre. Listen to everything he's telling you. I know you'll get frustrated. You'll get angry with them, because I know, just looking at Andre, I know what he's all about. I've met him once, recorded him once, but I know what he's all about. My advice to you, all right, growing up, listen. Yes, it will get frustrating.
Should have been around my son.
If you have a problem, we are all here to support you.
That's right. Yeah. Takes a village to raise a child.
We're all here to support you. We're all part of your family. Stay with it and you'll be a success.
And if I can add to that, fun guy, you know, one of the things that really helped me was having someone else in my life as well. I would recommend that
everybody
has
a mentor.
Have someone that you are accountable to. Mm-hmm. If there's somewhere you're trying to go, find someone who has already done it and let them help you. It's okay to ask for help. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. And there's going to be some things you just don't know. Now, you don't have to be smart, but you need to know what it is that you're trying to do. And there's no better person that can help you as someone who's done it before. So get yourself
a new job.
Just do me a favor. Just keep her away from me.
Really? Here's what we're going to do. No, I mean, everybody has been great, and thank you so much for sharing your story, your wisdom. Just to reiterate on that question that you had, Andre, to keep this motivation and inspiration going. When you guys are going out, I brought my vision board, one of them. So you have many vision boards where you can put together what it is that you want. And just like him, I have it, you know, in the hallway. I have, you know, it everywhere in the house. Business dream, you know, home dream, family dream. I have all of that. And most of the time, I look at them and I'm going, ooh, how did I get here? So that helps you to do that, plus the mentoring and the coaching. We both have paid coaches that we pay, as well as, you know, coach other people as well for us. So we do that in addition to that, and trying to do something about where you're going on a daily basis, that's going to help you. Because a lot of people say, well, you know, I want to do this, but then on a daily basis, you don't take that me time where you just structure yourself and work on you and what it is that you want in your life, you know, besides the family and the regular 9-to-5 job. That's what will get you there. So I encourage everyone to buy a copy of the book, and he can sign for you. I also brought some of my books there, and I hope to see all of you in the near future. Once again, hey, I'm looking forward to, we're gonna be speaking together. We're doing some seminars and conferences. I can't wait for those to happen. And, you know, come back to Boston soon.
Absolutely.
All right, thank you.
you for listening to the Dr. STEM Show. Please join us next Tuesday at 1 p.m. Pacific Time, 4 p.m. Eastern Time, and 9 p.m. GMT on the Voice America Empowerment Channel for another enlightening show. Have a terrific week.